And tonight's speaker is a very good friend of Archaeology Southwest. He came down to Tucson to work on a social networks grant with the University of Arizona while he was still in the final phases of his graduate work here at ASU. And as soon as the opportunity for a postdoc and came about, we said, Matt, please come to Archaeology Southwest and work with us for a while. And now he's back at ASU in a, I think, what is going to be a wonderful position where he gets to apply his creativity to a wider range of projects there at ASU. We'll be back teaching. We're planning partnerships and going forward with Matt. So a great friend of Archaeology Southwest. And the handout, if you haven't picked it up, is one of the Archaeology Southwest magazines on Southwest social networks. And Matt's going to be tapping into that social networks process. And we were discussing, we weren't really sure who wrote the title to the talk tonight, but you're going to hear about Chaco and the Chaco Social Networks Project, and it will cover those issues of relationships among social interaction, economics, and culture, but probably in a much more dynamic way than whoever wrote the the title. So without any more, I'm going to turn it over to Matt. Welcome, Matt.
Thank you, Bill. And I have to say, I'll take the blame for the title, because I think what happened is I didn't actually know what I was going to talk about when I first agreed to do this talk a long time ago. Because this the project, the Chaco Social Networks Project that I am going to talk about tonight, was still in the very beginning of data gathering when I agreed to give this talk, and I think I wasn't quite sure if I'd have anything to actually talk about. So I do, luckily, have something to talk about, so I'm not going to just stand up here and just ramble on about nothing. So that's good. These cafes are, you know, interesting and fun, and one of the things that's kind of unique about them is it's a different format because we don't have slides. You know, archaeologists love PowerPoint and slides and things like that, and Linda told me it's not cheating if I bring handouts and have things like this. So I don't have anything digital, but I do have a couple of handouts, and hopefully there's enough to go around. And I'm going to use those maps and some of the images on those handouts to kind of guide this discussion. So specifically, I'm going to talk about a new project that's a collaboration between the University of Arizona, Archaeology Southwest, and now ASU, now that I'm here at ASU. And it's known as the Chaco Social Networks Project. And as I'll describe over the course of this talk, basically what we're doing is we're trying to explore Chaco Canyon, and the Chacoan world, and I'll describe what I mean by that shortly, using methods of social network analysis that have been applied to modern societies, and you know, in becoming more and more frequent in recent years. And I'll go into a little bit more detail about that. But the first thing that I wanted to do is I kind of wanted to give you my perspective on Chaco. So if you ask 10 archaeologists what Chaco was and what Chaco was like, you're probably going to get 10 answers because there's a lot of disagreement about different things. So really what I'm going to be describing is my own perspective on Chaco and Chacoan developments through time. And you can take it as just that. And even members of our own project, we're collaborating closely on this, but we don't agree on everything. And I've included this map here on your handout. You have a copy of this same map here. Chaco Canyon should be labeled as the Chaco Core. So this is the Rio Chaco here. And right here in the center of the San Juan Basin is Chaco Canyon. So what is Chaco Canyon? So the most basic level, it's a canyon. It's a 14-kilometer long canyon in the center of the San Juan Basin. And one of my favorite definitions I've ever heard of Chaco given was by a colleague of mine, Scott Ortman, who called it the biggest, coolest thing that ever happened in the Southwest. I think that's a pretty good definition of Chaco. And as I talk about this, you'll get an idea of why that is. But in general, when archaeologists talk about Chaco, we're talking about the developments that relate to from the 9th through the 11th centuries in the canyon. And it's often described as an important center in the Southwest, especially in the 10th and 11th centuries. But I think there's new work that's actually pushing that further back in time. And so what do we mean by a center? Some archaeologists would disagree, but I argue that it's the key location in a social and political system connecting vast areas of the northern Southwest. In this map that I'm showing you here, you know, you've got Chaco Canyon, the Chaco Core labeled on your map there. All of these sites you see across this entire area are sites that are in some way affiliated with Chaco to varying degrees. So you can see this is a really, really large area. About 450 sites spanning the period from about 800 to a little bit after into the 1200s. So a really vast area that goes all the way from the White Mountains down to the bottom of the map up until the Four Corners in the Mesa Verde region at the top. So it's a very big area, and it's connected across vast landscape. So the hallmark of Chaco, and again on that same handout, I have pictures of architecture. So architecture and what we call great houses and great kivas are really what Chaco is known for. And if you look at your map, or the handout you have there, you have a map that's labeled Chaco Research Archive that's the largest of the great houses in Chaco Canyon known as Pueblo Benito. So that's about a 675-room pueblo, multiple stories. And if you haven't been to Chaco Canyon before, it's a National Historic Park. And I would definitely recommend leaving this talk and getting in your car and driving there right away if you haven't been there right away, because it's really, you know, Paul Reed, another archaeologist at Archaeology Southwest, says it's a crime to live on this earth and not have been to Chaco. That's what the way he always describes that. And I think it really is one of the most impressive places you can be. And we're not that far away from it here in the Phoenix area. So Chaco is known for this architecture. And what these great houses are, in a number of ways, is they're large and overbuilt houses. We call them great houses because in many ways they have features of the smaller kinds of pueblos and houses that people were living in. So above ground rooms and then sets of underground kivas. And you can see on that map that you can see sets of rooms in the back, kind of an arc of rooms in the back of that pueblo, and then kivas, those circular structures that are out in front of it. So in many ways, these are very impressive and overbuilt examples of normal kinds of household architecture, but they're built with a great degree of skill, and they're truly impressive with the scale and also the skill with which they're constructed. So if you go to Chaco today, you can see many of the walls still stand, you know, 4+ stories tall. You can see these things, especially the corners, will still be standing, sticking up well above the landscape, and you can really think of how impressive these things would have been. And so architecture is the primary way that people have probably looked at Chaco through time. So Chaco Canyon and developments in the canyon have been explored largely in terms of this impressive architecture, because it's probably the most visible and impressive aspect of Chacoan society. And great houses and great kivas in the Chaco Canyon region began being constructed in the late AD 800s. So I'm talking about the end of the 9th century. And it really expands dramatically after about 1040 or so, so AD 1040, so the middle of the 11th century. And that's often referred to as this Chacoan florescence. And a lot of old models suggest that many of the most important connections that Chaco had to areas outside of the Southwest and to more distant places of the Southwest primarily date to that period after 1040. So those are kind of the older models. And I'm going to suggest that a lot of those are being challenged with more recent work. So beyond those impressive constructions that are within the canyon itself, I said that all these sites across here are in some way related to the Chacoan system. So, and that's definitely by varying degrees. So what we often have during the Chacoan era across much of the northern Southwest is we have settlements that are considered outliers. So they're sites that are inspired by architectural developments in Chaco Canyon that are found in some places several days travel outside of the canyon itself. And these are often identified based on their architectural characteristics and to include things like the construction styles that are similar to those in the pueblos in Chaco Canyon, and also things like roads. But these vary in scale and in their characteristics quite a bit. So many of the great houses in the center of the Chaco Canyon, these are several hundred rooms. They are very, very, very large in scale. Some of these outlying sites may only be 10 rooms. Some of them may be basically the size of the room we're in right now. The footprint of some of the sites may be this small. But at the same time, we see that they have these very specific architectural features that harken back to Chaco. So there's definitely people that are building things in a style that's characteristic of Chaco. And in some cases, these Chacoan outlier sites were probably built by people directly from, with direct political and social ties to Chaco itself. And in other cases, these sites were probably built by local people in various areas who were inspired by this and perhaps were using the power of Chacoan ideology and Chacoan architecture for their own local ends. So they may have been trying to gain power on a local scale by tying themselves into this bigger Chacoan developments in the canyon itself. So there's on this map, you see about 450 sites. So this is a very inclusive map of what we might consider the Chacoan world, which is what we often refer to as this larger sphere. So, and what I mean by very inclusive is we're very loose in our definition of what we're including here. So we're including sites that only have a few features in common with sites in the Chaco region. And the reason we're doing that is we're trying to take some other lines of evidence other than architecture and see how these sites across this broader region maybe link into Chaco when we don't consider architecture alone, when we consider some other lines of evidence. So that's why we're taking such an inclusive view of this. But you can see on this map, just it covers almost every portion of the northern southwest for this period for about 800 to 1200, and especially after about 1040 is what most of these outlying sites date to. And so another, I'd kind of alluded to the fact that many archaeologists think of Chaco as this social and political system. So I want to say a little bit more about what I mean by that and talk a little bit about the extent to which I think developments across this entire huge area that I'm talking about here may have been integrated. So the construction of these great houses, and you can see on your map there, that Pueblo Bonito map again, the D-shaped structure there, it has several different construction phases that are shown in different colors. So you can see that red area in the back is the earliest construction, and then the blue and green construction phases were a little bit later in time. So this is a really complex site that was built not just all at once, but those rooms grew in several pulses over the course of that period from the late 800s into the early 1100s. And one of the things that's really interesting about that is that across all that time, there's a lot of evidence for planning in the construction of that and other great houses in the canyon. So to give you a sense of the scale, it's estimated that Pueblo Bonito there on your map likely required about 50,000 tons of sandstone just for Pueblo Bonito there. And there's about a dozen great houses within Chaco Canyon itself, so we might be talking more than 500,000 tons of sandstone to build those structures. So that's no small feat. You know, that's a huge amount of effort to build these structures. And these stones are shaped, you know, they're shaped in very fine ways where the corners and faces are flattened and smooth and ground and treated in various different ways. So that's a lot of effort goes into the construction of these. So that's one piece of evidence for planning and the scale that was likely involved in the construction of these. And the next piece of evidence is that if you've ever been to Chaco Canyon or seen pictures of Chaco Canyon, you know it's pretty much today a largely treeless landscape. You go out there today and you don't see trees, you don't see upland vegetation, you don't see these long trees that are used for beams that you actually see in the structures themselves growing anywhere in the landscape, anywhere nearby. So Chaco, you know, much like Pueblos and other parts of the Southwest, they build their roofs with these long trees that are like Douglas firs or spruce or things like that, many of which span multiple rooms. So they're very large beams, you know, larger than the ones you see in this Aztec room here. And they're prepared in special ways where the ends are flattened and cut very finely and things like that. But all of those trees, all of those large beams would have had to have come from about 30 to 50 miles away. So that's to build these structures within this canyon, they're coring and shaping 500,000 roughly tons of sandstone and then probably 250,000 trees of that scale are being brought in from 30 to 50 miles away. So that's a huge amount of effort. And there's actually some very recent work that was published in just December of last year where they're using some new methods. This was Gutierman and colleagues from the Tree Ring Lab down in Tucson who were using some new methods to actually source the trees that were being brought into to Chaco Canyon to construct these structures. And one of the interesting things they found is that they're coming from many different places, and often single rooms would even have beams from many different places. But there's also some really interesting patterns shifting through time. So what they found that was really unique is from the late 800s until about 1040 AD, the Zuni Mountains, which you can see on your maps there, kind of just due south of Chaco there. That was the primary source of trees prior to that period. And then after that period, you see a shift to the west of the Chusca Mountains, to the west. So with this new method of being able to actually source trees directly, based on looking at the tree ring patterns themselves, actually, and comparing that to rainfall sequences in different parts of the Southwest, they were able to show that pattern of obtaining wood from a long distance and having really directed relationships to these different places goes back to the very earliest periods in Chaco itself. So as early as the late 800s, already these regional systems were set up across the Southwest. In addition to the trees and the sandstone that I've talked about, I've also labeled or shown on your map these dotted lines which are extending out from Chaco Canyon in various ways. So those are roads, Chacoan roads. And these are features that are constructed probably mostly in the 11th century, but there may be some that are earlier as well. But these structures, these features, which are large clearings, often with sides that are built up in various ways, and they have varying degrees of formality in different portions along these. But one of the important features of these roads you'll see is they're very straight across long distances. We have one that extends from Chaco Canyon all the way to Cuts Canyon, kind of a little bit southeast of the Farmington area there. So that's, you know, that's many, many, many miles straight, going over hills, going just directly straight, no matter what the landform is they're encountering across this area. And you can see that there's this core of Chacoan sites kind of associated with that road system right in the middle of the map. So again, that's another piece of evidence talking about the integration of these Chacoan sites across the landscape to Chaco Canyon itself. So then beyond that, we also see that Chaco Canyon was a location that was where resources from many other parts of the Southwest were also being brought, and actually very, very far beyond the Southwest, as I'll discuss. So for example, there's evidence that corn grown in other parts of the San Juan Basin, which is this larger area here, was actually being brought into the Chaco Canyon area. So that's one thing, people are actually growing food and then bringing it there. And then there's chip stone from many parts of the Southwest. So the stone people are using to make stone tools, things from all the way here in Utah, things from down here in the Zuni area over in Arizona and the Chusca Mountains. All of those sources that are used for making stone tools in many parts of the Southwest are found both as raw materials and in the finished products at sites in Chaco Canyon. So people are bringing materials from vast distances. We also have turquoise, much of which is likely coming from areas further to the east off the map here. And some of the most exciting stuff is the evidence we have of things that are coming from much further away, like chocolate. So there's evidence that they actually have cacao, and that's being used in special ceramic vessels. If you flip over to the other side of that handout, I have a picture of this little cylinder vase, which is the one on the right-hand side there. And vessels like those at Chaco have been shown to actually contain remains of chocolate. And it's actually a vessel form that has some similarities to similar vessels that are used for chocolate also in Central America. So it suggests connections very, very, very far away during that time. And then also another kind of interesting one is macaws, so parrots. Macaws are being brought into Chaco Canyon alive, so we know they were there alive, and they're found buried, especially in some special context in places like Pueblo Bonito. And one of the interesting things about that is I've talked about all these different long-distance connections that that Chaco has, both within the Southwest and then far beyond the Southwest. And the old model was that these long-distance connections really emerged during the period when most of these outlying sites were built, which is about AD 1040 and later. That was sort of the original model, was that was really when all these long-distance connections fluoresced, and that's when Chaco increased in complexity, and that's when all these things were changing. But there's, you know, I talked already about how the tree, obtaining trees from long distance, that already predates that. Some work by Adam Watson and colleagues, again, on these macaws that were recovered from various sites in Chaco Canyon, they actually were able to C14 date the macaws themselves. And what they found is actually a lot of them, and actually most of the macaws that were in that area were probably obtained prior to that AD 1040 period. So that's really important. You know, this changing in dating is really important because it suggests even as late as the late 8800s, some of those really long distance connections that characterize Chaco that we think of as sort of the classic hallmarks of the 11th century in Chaco, many of those probably started 100 years earlier or more, which is really kind of an exciting development. And what that also means is that we need to kind of reevaluate how we think complexity and political organization developed at Chaco, because it seems it was there from the beginning, from the very beginning of the construction of these settlements, rather than something that developed over the course of a century or more as Great House construction continued into the canyon. And then finally, if you look at this map again on your handout, I've got some structures you'll notice labeled as post-Chacoan. So post-Chacoan Great Houses and post-Chacoan Great Kivas. So what do I mean by that on here? So construction of Great Houses and Great Kivas in the center of Chaco Canyon, right there in the middle of the map, in the Chaco core, began to wane by about AD 1130. So by about the middle, early to mid 12th century. And then at the same time, we start to see a fluorescence of architecture that's Chacoan inspired, but also distinct and innovative in some ways in other parts of the Southwest, and in particular in the Farmington area near Aztec. And I've labeled the Aztec core on your map there as well. You can see that's just directly north of Chaco Canyon, right up that what we call the Great North Road, which is that road leading due north from the canyon itself. So it's interesting, and perhaps, you know, that road may have been connecting these sites, not just in space, but connecting sites with through time as well, is one interpretation is that. And many people have argued, including Paul Reed again from Archaeology Southwest, that the developments at Aztec in the Farmington area were really a continuation of Chacoan society. And they were probably, there's a lot of good evidence that they were actually a continuation involving a lot of the people that were in Chaco previously. So they probably involved migration of especially probably some leaders from Chaco Canyon up into that area where they're reestablishing Chacoan society in a new setting. So when I'm talking about post-Chaco, I'm talking about this period after 1130 and developments that are inspired by Chaco but outside of the canyon itself. And Aztec is probably the continuation of that. When we look in other parts of the Southwest, especially down in the Zuni region, down here where I've done a lot of my own work, there's actually more post-Chacoan Great Houses than Chacoan Great Houses in this area, but they seem to really have a local flavor. They seem to really be locally focused. So although they have architectural features that are inspired by Chaco, we don't see evidence of really strong connections to Aztec, for example. So in many ways, although Aztec may have been the heir to Chaco and what Chaco had been, it seems to have been a system that was a lot less integrated than what had been in Chaco. So things did change as well. And so that's kind of just my perspective on Chaco and Chacoan development. So I just wanted to summarize a couple of the key points that'll go into now when I talk about the Social Networks Project. So Chaco was big and important, and it spawned imitators, and also it had its own politically possibly subservient sites across a huge area of the Southwest. The importance of Chaco and its long-distance connections in the Southwest and even across into Central America likely began much earlier than has traditionally been appreciated by the late 8800s, or maybe even earlier and elsewhere, but that's a different story that I can talk a little bit about if people are interested. And Chaco as a system did expand dramatically in the mid-11th century, so after about AD 1040. But after the construction declined in Chaco, we see a somewhat less centralized system focused on Aztec in particular that likely involved the migration of Chacoan people into that region. So that's sort of my broad brush Chaco in 20 minutes. There's a lot of complexity to this, you know, when we get into the nitty-gritty of all these details. But I think that those are some of the big historical processes that were happening in this part of the Southwest through time. And some of the things that I described today would have been different had I been given this lecture even a couple of years ago. So there's a few key things that have happened in the last few years that have really changed our picture of how and when some of these big developments in Chaco occurred. So what I'm going to talk about now is the Southwest Social Networks Project in the Chaco region. So the Southwest Social Networks Project is a project, again, from U of A, Archaeology Southwest, and now ASU, where we're trying to use methods and models from sociology and social network analysis to explore archaeological changes in deep time through archaeological remains. And this project involves archaeologists, geochemists, computer scientists, sociologists, GIS specialists. We've got people with a lot of different specialties that are all working on this together. And what we're interested in is exploring the development and scale of Chacoan influence through time by exploring material culture, so the things that people made and used and discarded. And this includes architecture, of course, but we want to move beyond the architecture model that's been so much the focus of Chaco to things that have gotten less attention, like ceramic remains, the everyday ceramics that people are using, and also lithic materials. These things haven't been completely ignored, but we're looking at them in a new way with much better data than has been possible in the past. And yeah, we're certainly not the first to approach an exploration of the Chaco world using material culture, but we've got data of a scale and quality that's never been available. So we've got ceramic data from about 400 of these sites across here. So actually a pretty substantial proportion of the ones you see on this map, we have systematic ceramic data. And I think the running count right now is 2.1 million ceramic objects that have been typed to a specific type. So that represents 150 years of work of people, you know, excavating these things and then analyses of collections. And Tom Wines, who's one of the people that works on this project with us, we were recently calculating this, and he may be responsible for about a third of that, which is quite amazing over the course of his career, just how many things he's done that are included in this database. So that Archaeology Southwest magazine that you got when you came into this lecture, that's focused on an earlier version of this project. We were looking at the period from AD 1200 to 1450 or 1500 across the western half of the Southwest. And in that, we're using similar methods, so these social network methods, to try to explore migration and how migration influenced patterns of population movement through time across that portion of the Southwest. And as we did this, and at the same time we were doing that work, all these developments that I've been talking about and the changing perspectives on Chaco and the timing of developments in Chaco were happening at the same time. And that really got us interested in what could we do by applying similar methods to the Chacoan sphere at this time. So I want to back up for just a second and just describe a little bit more generally what social networks are, what social network analyses are, and why we think they're a useful method of exploring these patterns. So a network, in just the simplest terms, is just a set of people, or it could be villages, it could be groups of people, it could be websites or anything, and just a formal description of the relationships among them. All it means is that we have a set of formally defined nodes, we'll call them. So these are just the actors in this network. And we know something about who is connected to whom based on some kind of relationship. This could be friendship. This could be patterns of people emailing each other. This could be people that are members of teams within the work setting, or any number of things like that. And to give you one example that I'm kind of fond of using, because people are sort of familiar with this, you know, social networks, people probably go right away to Facebook and think of things like that in today's day and age. And if you look on the top left on the handout on the side that's got the images of the ceramic vessels on there, you can see a network. And that network there is my own Facebook network that I created. And if anybody's interested, I can tell you how you do this yourself as well. And every one of the dots on that is one of my Facebook friends. And the connections are not from me to those people, but instead it's among people that are my friends. So this is the connections between people that are also friends of mine. And by looking at something like this, the idea behind social network analysis is by examining this kind of network, we can say something about the context and of interactions among these people. For example, you can see from this this plot here that I don't have any sort of outliers. So I don't have a single Facebook friend that's not friends with at least one other Facebook friend of mine. So that says something about my network and sort of how I keep it relatively closed, for example. And we can also see clusters on here, several distinct clusters within this network. For example, in orange and green on the left-hand side, we have a cluster that's largely people revolving around Tempe, Arizona, and Arizona State University. And then on the bottom there, University of Arizona and Tucson, Arizona. And there's actually a fair number of connections between those two, despite what you might hear sometimes. Then over to the east, you can see areas that relate more to my hometown, where I grew up, and in the University of Texas, where I did my undergraduate degree. So it's all the places I've lived and worked form these little clusters within the network. And then you can see the red dot in the center is the only person within this network that connects all these diverse clusters, and that's my wife, Melissa. And she always says she should be the most connected node in my network, as she always jokes with me on this. But in some ways, you know, that's one way of thinking how a network like this can say something about me, but also say something about how I've organized my relationships. And by formally looking at these kinds of things, we can get a sense of the texture of changing patterns of social relationships through time. So for example here, one way of assessing connections among these people is by looking at which people are the most central. And there's a lot of different ways of defining centrality, but we might define it as people that connect the most other people that would otherwise be unconnected. So who are the people that are really the intermediates within these networks? And you can see my wife there is definitely that within my own network. So when we're thinking about this archaeologically, we might be interested in thinking about what settlements or areas of the Southwest within the Chacoan sphere might be similarly intermediate. You know, might there be certain areas where key sites are in key positions where they actually are connecting people that would otherwise not be connected? Where was that settlement not there? So these are the kinds of things that we wanted to address with the Southwest Social Networks project data. So then, so networks are good for a number of things, I would argue. So they're good for formally describing interactions. They're good for visualizing patterns of relationships, like I've shown you here. And increasingly, I don't really have to describe this in too much detail because these kinds of things are becoming common in like news articles, for example. Like I saw a great recent one that was showing examples of which candidates were funded by which corporations, and you could really see how, you know, one corporation's funding all of them, for example, in a lot of cases. And it's also, social network analysis is a set of tools, so there's a lot of well-established methods from sociology and other fields that we're able to use by doing things in this formal way. And it's also, I would argue, just a model for thinking about social groups. So the basic premise that we're agreeing on by doing this kind of analysis is that if we know something about the relationships among some set of people, we also may be able to predict how relationships might change or other aspects of that person. So we may be able to say something about someone based purely on the structure of their relationship. So, you know, everything I've talked about so far, these examples, I'm talking about networks of, you know, email, friendship, those kinds of things, the Facebook friends example. So how do we get at this archaeologically? How can we do this with archaeological data? And it gets a lot more complicated. But what we do in this project, and what we've done in the past project that's described in the Archaeology Southwest magazine, is we look at similarities in the material culture that people used and discarded at settlements. And the basic premise is that people who made and used similar things were likely involved in similar networks of interaction and exchange. And in the Chacoan example, this includes looking at similarities in painted and unpainted ceramics and the lithic materials they're using for stone tools. And also things we can geochemically source, like obsidian, which is a volcanic glass that we can actually source to specific places. So we're looking as part of this project, we're looking at all those different lines of evidence along with architecture that has been the hallmark of Chaco for a long time. But we also wanted to look at some of these other lines of evidence. And I'm going to talk specifically about the ceramic results here. And I've included a few images on that same handout. Pictures of vessels that are in styles associated with Chaco. So you can see that cylinder vessel that I referred to with the chocolate, that was the form that was typical of the pots that were used for chocolate. You can see what we call a hasher design. So we have outlined areas with these thin diagonal lines marked all the way across them there. And that's really a design style that's characteristic of the Chacoan region after about 1040. And again, interestingly, this is something that's not just made in one area and then exchanged to all these places, but people are making this in many different places. So people across this vast area are, in their own local way and using their own local materials, making things that have this stylistic and social connection back to Chaco itself. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to formally look at the ceramics that we have that were recovered from all these sites and see the extent to which the ceramics from this site were similar to this site, and this site similar to this site, and how all of those were similar to Chaco. So really what we're interested in is the relationship of all of these sites back to Chaco, but also the relationships among all of these sites themselves. And this is really brand new. Like I made these images that you see on here. You're the first people outside of the project to see these, so this is brand new. And the images of the three maps at the bottom with the blue and white lines on there, I made the day before yesterday. So this is just brand new work. You guys, we're going to present this at the Society for American Archaeology meeting in a few weeks, but you guys are the first to be able to see this. And I've rather than sticking the whole, we have actually 19 different intervals from AD 800 to 1275 that we're able to show, given the chronological resolution of ceramics we have in this area. And I've just pulled three here that kind of relate to some of those big themes of Chaco that I've discussed throughout the earlier portion of this talk. So on each of these maps, every one of those red dots you can see is a Chacoan site that was occupied during that time. So every one of those red dots on those black and white maps is a Chacoan site. So that's either a great house or a great kiva across the region. And then we can see the lines that are drawn between them. I can describe the specifics if people want in the questions, but I'll just say that those are sites that are represented by very strong similarities in the ceramics that are used and discarded there. So those are among the strongest connections in terms of similarities of the pottery that we find at the sites. We have the lines drawn between them. And they're color-coded based just on the physical distance between those sites. So on each of those maps, white lines between a pair of sites indicate sites that were very close together, less than 25 kilometers apart, so just less than a day's travel apart from each other. And then the lighter blue is a little bit further, and then the darker blue, some of those extend even past 250 kilometers. So sites that are more than 250 kilometers apart, but are still highly similar in terms of the ceramics that are used and discarded there. And so I've got also, you can't see it in all these slides because they're covered up by the network ties, but I've also included these core ceramic, or the core roads within the Chacoan era in yellow. And they weren't necessarily built during that early interval, but I've got them there just to help you position yourself when you look at these maps. So the first map that I've got there is that early period of Chacoan developments in the region, so the late 800s, so about 875 to 900. And as I'd said previously, you know, this is when great house construction is really getting started in the canyon. And we have all these new ideas from things like the wood data that I talked about in the macaw, redating of the macaws, that actually a lot of these things we think of Chaco having these distant connections probably started much earlier than we previously appreciated. And one of the things that we're able to show by looking at these comparing ceramics across this entire region is, yes, we do actually see strong evidence of connections to many places across the Southwest, to the south, to the west, and to the north as well, as early as the late 800s. So already at the very beginnings of when Chaco and great house construction was getting started, already there's a lot of evidence that this is a broader system that's extending beyond the canyon. So this right at the very beginning, we're seeing those distant connections. So that's one important point. The next point that I want to make is about what we think of as traditionally as the height of the Chacoan system. So that middle map shows the period from 1050 to 1075. And again, all those red dots are Chacoan sites, and Chacoan outliers are great kivas across the region. And you can see there's many more during this period. You can see, you know, this is really the period when there are the most great houses across the region. And you can see, again, vast connections extending back to Chaco Canyon right there in the center. And those points on this map are scaled such that sites that are more intermediate, I talked about how being intermediate in a network might be important, sites that are more intermediate or larger in these plots. And again, you can see actually sites within the canyon itself are some of the most intermediate. So sites within the canyon are really linking areas that would otherwise not be connected were it not for the sites in the canyon themselves. And interestingly, you can see some clustering as well. So you see a large cluster that includes Chaco and then many areas down to the south, all the way down to the edge of the Mogollon Rim. And then you could see another cluster up here in southeast Utah and southwestern Colorado, what's kind of known as the Northern San Juan or the Greater Mesa Verde region during that period. So that's the height of the Chacoan era. And then finally, I have one last map on here that relates to the end, when construction is waning within Chaco Canyon. So what's happening to networks of interaction across this region as construction is waning within the canyon itself? And you can see on this map on the right here, again, a very large cluster of settlements to the south, including the Chuscas, the Zuni area, areas on the edge of the Mogollon Rim, all connected to Chaco. And then you can see a number of sites, a number of connections extending from sites in the Chaco area and further south, north, really kind of paralleling the North Road here in many ways, up towards the northern part of the southwest, towards southeast Utah, southwestern Colorado, the greater Mesa Verde area. And you can see now, if we look at which sites are most intermediate, most central within this network, one area that really stands out is now Aztec. So I talked a little bit about how there's this shift from Chaco to Aztec that likely involved migration, that likely involved a movement of some of the political and social authority that Chaco had to the north at that time. So I think we actually see evidence of that by looking at ceramics in this. So we're able to see this with a level of specificity that hasn't been possible in the past. So people have speculated about patterns of interaction and how they change through time based on ceramics across the Chacoan region through time. But this is the first time we've really been able to parse this into really small temporal intervals and look at it at a scale that's never been possible. So there's never been this kind of data gathered at the scale. And you know, this is just what I've talked about so far is really just we're just scratching the surface with this. You know, we finished gathering data for this project at the beginning of this semester, so right at the beginning of the semester in January, roughly. And we've been, you know, crunching the numbers and doing all kinds of analyses on this. This is just one first cut of what we've been able to do. We've got 50 other really interesting and amazing things that I'd love to tell you about, you know, once we have our results solidified. But really, doing this kind of analysis on this data in this context, especially in light of all the new things that are happening and new things we're learning about Chaco, has been really exciting. And we're excited to talk more about this as well. So at this point, that's sort of what I wanted to just give you the overview of my perspective on Chaco and then the project and where we are now. But I can take any questions we have. Yeah, so the question is, later on in time in those networks, what you sort of see is people moving towards the source of where resources are and things like that. And that is definitely one thing that people have argued. You know, we talked about Chaco being in this landscape that it had agricultural potential when people were living there, and people were able to grow quite a bit of food there. But you're right, that portion of the San Juan River, why weren't they always there? You know, that's this amazing place where you can do kinds of agriculture that you can't do elsewhere. And that's something that people have really explored. And one thing that folks like Paul Reed and others who have explored this, they really do think that one of the things that's happening is they're moving toward where really good agricultural land and consistent water are found. Because one of the things that's concurrent with that movement out of Chaco is also a period of environmental unpredictability at the same time. So having a more dependable source of water for agriculture and things like that was probably increasingly important towards the end. And also, you know, they'd weathered various kinds of environmental upturns, downturns in the Chaco region. But that one hit at, you know, a period when there's many more people involved in the system, and they're really pushing the resources in a way that perhaps they hadn't been in the past. So yeah, that's, you know, very much probably played into that decision towards the end to shift up towards riverine resources and areas that were better watered. Any more insight on the absence of graves? There actually are quite a few. Yeah, you know, so there's some very famous ones actually from Pueblo Bonito. There's a few rooms that are in the oldest portion of the Pueblo where there's people that are buried in these rooms, and actually it's set up in such a way that people probably had access to communicate back to those people, so they were probably open in a way where people could actually talk through to the rooms where these people were, for example. So it seems like, yeah, there are some specific kinds of mortuary treatments that happen at Chaco that are probably distinct to that area. But mm-hmm. Where does Zuni come into the picture in time? Okay, so the early period that I was talking about, where we're talking about trees from the Zuni region, so that starts in the late 800s. Yeah, so that starts in the late 800s and it goes to about 1040 when it's eclipsed by the Chuscas. But if you look at this area north of the Zuni Mountains, this what's known as the sort of Red Mesa Valley area, concurrent with that early procurement of wood, there's a series of Chacoan sites constructed in that area. So that's maybe outside of the Zuni area, because it's northeast of the Zuni Mountains, but that's probably, those sites were probably directly involved in that procurement of wood. There's a couple of sites on the Zuni reservation themselves, on itself, that are actually very early Chacoan great houses. So they probably start in the early 900s. So that's on the early end for most places. Most of the great houses in the Zuni region post-date 1040, 1050, just like many other places. But Zuni did have some very early connections to Chaco itself, as does the Mesa Verde region. Both of those areas have some early connections to that region. So she was asking if that has something to do with the trade routes and the macaws. You know, one of the things that's so interesting about Zuni to me, so there's a lot of things that are interesting about it. It's a linguistic isolate, and a lot of times when things change across different parts of the Southwest, Zuni's just left out. It's always interesting to me, like in the 1300s, there's these huge changes across the entire Southwest. It happens about 125 years later in the Zuni region, some of those same changes. And I've often wondered about that. And when we look at change through time in rare objects, things like copper bells and macaws and turquoise and things like that, a lot of those things are present in Zuni in the early period, so sort of into the 900s, but they kind of skip the period from about 1000 to about 1300. There's this period where things like macaws are just, you know, although there's been excavations of like Village of the Great Kivas, a very large Chacoan site in on the Zuni reservation was excavated, and we have none of those things. So I think in some ways they're conspicuously absent from that. So it's not exactly clear if Zuni was part of that exchange connections through that area. I think they were definitely connected to Chaco in important social ways. We definitely see that they were building structures that were inspired by Chaco. But to my mind, in the Zuni areas where I've done a lot of my work, a lot of them are very much local in flavor. So they seem to be sites that were probably built by, I would argue, local people trying to draw on the power of what Chaco was without necessarily having very strong direct connections. I think that's not true of the Red Mesa Valley, that area that I talked about first on the east side, on the northeast side of the Zuni Mountains. But if we're talking about Zuni proper on the area in and around the reservation today, I think that's the case. So it's actually kind of an interesting puzzle. Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things that these images perhaps don't convey perfectly is that when I've drawn these lines on these maps, we're basically, for visualization purposes, we're selecting some level of connection between these places as a line, and if it's beyond that threshold, it doesn't have a line between those sites. And we have to do that to be able to just simplify this for the purpose of visualization. When we actually do our analyses, we don't look at these specific lines, but we actually look at the raw data. And what we can actually see is there are actual connections between Aztec and Chaco, but just the connections to the south are so much stronger between Chaco and those areas to the south on those time periods that I have shown here, that those are kind of swamped out when we're making this kind of simplified display. I don't have every time period on here, but if I were to show you the subsequent periods after what we're talking about here, after sort of the real decline of Chaco and things like that, you would actually see that bridge really running right along that Great North Road between Aztec to the north, Chaco to the south, but there were far fewer people then at that time. So there's strong evidence in the latest construction and occupation of Chaco Canyon itself of a Mesa Verde area connection. So there's a lot of material cultural similarities to things we see in Mesa Verde into the Chaco Canyon in the late period. And I think probably if I showed you the next interval, you'd be able to see that a little bit better, but yeah. No, so he was asking, I made the point that the developments in Chaco Canyon started in the 800s, but I was also talking about how, he's asking, you know, did it start there? Did it come in from somewhere else? And I talked about a lot of the things that we think of as the system were already kind of intact from very early on. So we might be suspicious that maybe something is going on a little bit earlier. There's a lot of work recently among people that worked in the Mesa Verde region especially, and they're looking at earlier settlements in places like in the Dolores area and things like that, where there's some early work that's done on sites that date also to the early 800s. And what they see is some sites that maybe aren't great houses by our definition of great houses, but they have architecture that's a little bit finer than their neighbors. And they're built in these arcs that are very characteristic of these later, like the Pueblo Bonito great house you can see there. And there's a lot of architectural similarities that probably go a little bit further back to an area up here in southwestern Colorado a little bit earlier. And there's been a lot of work documenting that connection between this area and this area. And I would argue that there's actually a lot of similarities as well between areas to the south and there, but we haven't really looked at early Chaco with that in mind yet. I think the focus so far, there's been a lot of people that have even argued that Chaco was a migration of people from the Mesa Verde region into the Chaco region in the 800s. They've argued that that's sort of like the origin of this was people moving out of that Dolores area and other places down into this, and they're bringing this system with them. I think that we've just got so much more excavation data from this area from a few large projects that have happened in there, and we have comparatively less from areas to the south. I actually think there's a lot of strong connections between these areas to the south early and things we see in Chaco. So I actually think it's likely, and this is something we hope to explore with this project, that those early connections might have involved migration of people from more than one area into the Chaco region. And that's a model that goes back. It's a very early model for sort of the dual society within Chaco of people from different places living side by side. And I think we have data that are going to allow us to test that in a new way. So that's something we're really interested in. Thank you. So he was saying they had items from Mesoamerica and some trade with Mesoamerica, and he was asking if they had architectural input from their sites as well. There are some key characteristics of some of these sites that people have related to Mesoamerican architecture. For example, at Chetro Kettle, there's a long wall that has a series of columns that are sort of built. There are these sort of windows that are spaced evenly across that has been related to colonnade plazas and things like that are characteristic of Mesoamerican architecture at the time. I think a lot of people, when they've looked for inspiration of Mesoamerican connections in architecture to Chaco, they've often looked at places like Tula and Toltec sites because they're contemporaneous with what we think of as the height of Chaco again. But I'm actually now thinking, you know, now that we're kind of pushing some of these dates back and things like that, there's places in West Mexico where there's, to me, suspiciously similar architectural remains and things like that, that I think, you know, if we open ourselves up to thinking about where some of these inspirations might have come from and what people may have been familiar with and what kind of symbolism they were trying to draw on when they built Chaco, that might be where we're able to see some of those more direct connections to that as well. So, does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does.
Okay. Of the very specific features of Chaco, yeah. So he was asking at Aztec, and this is true, that the earliest occupation and the earliest construction there, people have argued, is Chacoan migrants because there's very specific features of the way they're built that relate to Chaco. Things like having a tree that spans multiple rooms that has walls built off in a certain way that once you're done building the building, you can't really tell that that's the way that it's done, but that's the way it's done in Chaco and that's the way it's done in Aztec. So it's something you can't really see in the finished architecture, but they share across that area. And later settlements, in later construction in Aztec, and also some of the later settlements have a more local character again, like you're saying as well. So he was asking if there's other sites like that with characteristics of, as you know, with Chacoan, evidence of Chacoan migrants in that way. So Salmon is another one, you know, not very far away from Aztec that has some similar. There's actually the layout of Salmon and how it was built is very similar to a contemporaneous structure, one of the later structures that was actually built in Chaco itself. They to Hongo Pavi, they're very similar if you look at sort of the way they're laid out. We don't have the kind of excavation and really detailed information at many other great house sites to the south. So to the south, we've got little windows into some of these sites from and the excavations have been at smaller scale. We have a few others in places like Lowry and southwestern Colorado, but this is really where the bulk of the excavation data comes from. So I think that's why we're able to see some of that. One thing I'll say about if we look at site layouts, and I have on that first site in the handout, here on the top, these are a couple of great house sites from Chaco Canyon itself. And then on the bottom, we can see great house sites from outside of the canyon. And you can see that some of those on the outside of the canyon, you know, if you look at the layouts, it's maybe not all that convincing that they have a strong Chacoan connection. It's really the specific details of architecture that are relating those to that. But if you look at, for example, Cox Ranch on the bottom right there, that's a great house site that's actually in the middle of an area that's traditionally considered Mogollon. So it's a great house site that's sort of plopped down in the middle of this Mogollon area. But it's actually, in terms of layout and construction, it's one of the most Chacoan. So it's really interesting how, you know, you don't necessarily see the patterns. It's not necessarily further away you get from Chaco, the less similar it is. It's really sort of hops and skips and jumps. And that's why I argue that some of these outliers represent probably migrants from the Chaco region or people that had direct connections to that area. And others were probably just local inspiration based on Chacoan architectural symbolism. Thanks. Any other questions? So he's asking about the expansion of Highway 491 that runs kind of along Arizona-New Mexico border, kind of east of the Chuscas in this area. Yeah, those excavations related to that construction are still ongoing, and they're actually doing some really interesting work. I haven't been involved in that directly, so I only know this kind of secondhand, but they've actually excavated at some great Kiva sites in that area, and they've located some additional Chacoan sites that we didn't know about previously, some of which we were actually able to include in this data because they shared those data with us as well. But I think, you know, that and then some other work that's going on along the I-40 corridor, we're going to get a new window into especially the early period, just because of where things are, that's what people happen to be intersecting. So we're going to get a different picture of that than we've had in the past. And most of that work has, some of the field work's been completed, some of it's ongoing, but the reports are going to be years before they come out. So you'll have to wait a little while before you know the details. So he was noticing on this map that many sites have great houses and great kivas, and some just have one or the other. Some are only great houses, some are only great kivas. One thing you'll notice is there's a lot of spatial structure to especially the distribution of great kivas. So if we look down here in the southwestern portion of the map, there's an area where there's great kivas galore, actually a really high density of great kivas, but no great houses. Nothing that people have been able to agree upon as a great house. There's a few things that have some similarities, but there's really nothing that is unambiguously a great house in that area. And that's one of the areas where, this is work that was largely done by Sarah Herr, Desert Archaeology, where in the Mogollon Rim area, where she's basically arguing that this Mogollon Rim was a frontier between ancestral Puebloan populations to the north and then other populations in the Mogollon region to the south. And even earlier in time, there's connections to the Hohokam region in that area. And what she's arguing, that this area was what we might think of as land rich and labor poor. So there's a lot of agricultural land. There's not that many people there to actually make use of it in some ways. And she makes some convincing arguments that the construction of this density of great kivas that were constructed in this area, when there's not actually that many people in here compared to somewhere over here in the San Juan Basin, this is a low population density area. She's argued that this kind of overconstruction of great kivas in this area may have been an effort to recruit people into that area to take advantage of the land surplus that they did have when they had a labor scarcity. And you also noticed that many of these other sites have great houses without great kivas. They're not necessarily spatially structured, although you can see along that north road a few of these small structures without great houses without great kivas. And in that case, it's a little bit more difficult to know what to make of that. But one thing that I will say is that if you look at Chaco Canyon itself, you can see Chaco Wash goes along the edge of the canyon there. And in most time periods, we have a concentration of great houses north, concentration of great kivas to the south. And I talked about, you know, connections to the north, connections to the south. I alluded to some early great house connections to the north, and actually there's some early great kivas to the south. So we may sort of be seeing some of the patterns of those different populations that came together in Chaco by seeing, you know, which areas have what and looking at the changing distribution of those through time. So, well, thank you, everyone. Thank you. Yeah.